the stories of Brisco and Bradshaw, I would be Bradshaw, and that would be the WWE Hall of Famer, Oklahoma's favorite son, Mr. Gerald Brisco. And oh, you didn't know, we got the six-time tag team champion, intercontinental champion, one of the greatest characters in what some say the greatest era in professional wrestling. We got the D-O-double-G, the Mr. Road Dogg, Jesse James. Brian, welcome to the show.
John, thank you so much for that. Man, I was just kind of listening to all the things I did. I was like, man.
You're really important.
How to go back and watch some of this stuff.
Hey, Brian, you should.
I'm old. I was decent at it.
Brian, you're awesome, man. John said, you know, we need somebody. And I said, you want me to call somebody? I had to get that up. So I reached out to the Road Dogg, and here you are, man. We finally get somebody on this program that can add a little bit beside more John there.
All right. Well, look, I appreciate you guys having me. So let's get started.
There's nothing like two really old guys doing your catchphrases. I think it's cool.
yeah, or three really old guys trying to hook up on a Zoom call. Technologically.
Well, we gotta give you props here. You're better than most of our guests on there. You're getting that Zoom thing going. You know, you popped up just boom. There's Brian.
For some reason, and I know this is gonna sound nonsensical, I went to check my audio settings, and it said use with computer audio. Well, I didn't want to use computer audio. I wanted to use my Shure microphone that Conrad was nice enough to send me. So I was actually doing better than I expected to be doing. Finally, I just said, screw it, I'm going with the computer audio. And here we are.
It looks like you got that halo light there in front of you, too.
Yeah. It's the halo. It's like we talked about, I'm an influencer, Gerald. I influenced a generation to tell people to suck it. So I got that to live on.
Oh, speaking of suck it, you know, Brian, we mentioned earlier before we got on the show, you know, our paths crossed way, way back. I was, of course, friends with your dad back when he got in the business. We're both young rookies in the business. I remember him proudly bringing his boys along to some of the events at the Omni, especially when we sold out and he was on main event.
Yeah.
You know? the entire James family showed up. That was
I guarantee weekend. His family was coming. He was going
Which home. Was very frequent, by the way, too. You
know? Yeah. I remember when I was, and I'll never forget it, when I was 4 years old, he beat Bobby Duncan in the Omni in a Cadillac tournament, and he was wearing the white singlet, and Bobby Duncan either busted him open or he got color. I never really asked him, but he bled like a pig, and he won, but there he was soaked in blood and won, the hometown boy in Atlanta. Like, I'll never forget that. And I was 4 years old.
Brian, I hate to push your bubble, but he got juice that night. Stand in, busted him over.
Yeah. And that's what, later in life, I figured that one or the other happened. But it was not the moment that will stick with me. It was the fear of seeing my father covered in blood. And I was too young. You know, my other brothers are 10 or whatever, and they probably got it. But I was like, oh, my God, what happened to my dad?
Yeah. You know, and you mentioned White. And John and I, you know, we've done a lot of these best of matches where we see a lot of old-timers out there. And usually, I brought it up on a match, and John, but we usually like Dusty have a white T-shirt on, or one of the guys have that white T-shirt, player have a white T-shirt on. All of a sudden, here comes the color. Oh, Why do they wear white? Bob wearing red bullet ball. All of a sudden, get out of his red or blue singlet and go to the white.
He
was winning that title, brother. He wanted to get that sympathy before, Nobody was better than Bullet Bob doing it.
Man, you know what's great to hear, Gerald, and you always told me, but I guess it was something, you know, you would tell me stories about him, and I'd heard stories about him, but it's almost like now that I'm older and he's gone, and I'm just remembering, and like now that I'm hearing people talk about him, I'm realizing that there were his peers, you know what I mean? Like in this time and generation where I was looking up to him like he was larger than life figure on television, and you guys were working with him on a nightly basis. And I would argue that you knew him better than I did, but not for the last 10 years, you know, for the last 10 years, I really cemented my relationship, and I was such in a good place spiritually when he passed, that it was almost a peaceful thing. And I literally held his hand in my house, and I told him, I said, Marine, go, your duty is over. go home, you know, because he was laying there fighting. And but that's the kind of relationship we had at the end. So it was very cool. What I really love is hearing it from the perspective of his peers. When I heard Robert Fuller and Ron and Jimmy Golden did a podcast all about him, and it was just so cool for me to hear those stories on now that I've been in the business. I was a wrestler, I've worked behind the scenes, I've done, you know, I've kind of done it all in there too. Now I see him as a peer almost also. So that's, it's really cool where I'm at right now in my life as far as my relationship with my father goes.
That's an awesome story. You know, I kind of equate Bullet Bob with another local hero that I got to break into business with, and that'd be Danny Hodge. Danny Hodge, of course, was just so over in Oklahoma and Arkansas, that entire era, that area that he worked. You get in a car with Danny, I mean, and you'd be at a stoplight, 20 people be rushing in the car wanting an autograph. It was the same way when your dad in that Georgia, Alabama area there.
Yeah.
You're in a car with Bullet Bob, man, you're a hero just by association. And those two guys were so relatable in their time, you know. Both of them were good, solid country folk that had that country values to them. And the people could read that. And your dad was as genuine as any guy I'd ever come across. And man, what a major superstar, John. This guy come from a local, he was a farmer, man, a local farmer, got in the business. And, you know, the farmers are hero anyway. And then the two just came together. And man, I got the honor to see Bob getting that big push into that title match and into world title matches. And the folks they were screaming like Elvis was coming to the building every time Bullet Bob walked to the ring. And my road trip, I mean, as you know, Brian, I've told you many times,
but yeah,
he was my roadmate, you know. Yeah. And so we had a lot of fun time together.
Yeah.
Some of them I can't even tell you his son, you know.
Yeah. Same, I assure you.
He's one of the few guys, Brian, I stood in line for. Your dad. You know, always, you know, when the legends come around, you know, you always, you know, of course go by and pay respect.
Yeah.
Dad was there. First time I ever got to meet him, I thought, shit, that's full of Bob. And there was like some people talking to him, and I literally just stood and waited in line like like the mark that I am. And,
yeah.
And I got to meet him. He was so nice. You know, he knew you and I were friends. He was just nice as he could be. But I remember thinking that this is a big deal. That's freaking Bullet Bob.
Yeah. So it's weird for me. This is the truth. It's weird for me to see him as that, other than just my dad and like, oh, he's Superman. You know what I mean? I just see him as that, like another person I would see. Like if I were to see Jesus sitting at a booth and talking to some people, I would wait in line to talk to him. If I were to see Elvis, I would probably wait a minute or two, but not too long. There's just not a lot of people nowadays that you go, man, and to hear people talk about my father that way is, it touches me, and not in the bad place that Uncle JoJo. No, but it does. It touches my heart, and it lets me look at him from a different perspective, like I was talking about earlier. But also, I run into that same thing with me. Like you mentioned all that stuff. Like I don't know, it just feels heavy in a way. Like I want to shake it off. I don't know. It just feels weird to talk about all my accomplishments. I don't know. That just feels weird to me.
And you know what was so great about it, Brian, was that was in a time when the wrestling had the highest ratings of all time. You know, the Attitude Era guys, you look at how popular they are at conventions and things, because that's when so many people were watching. You know, Stone Cold was hot, The Rock was hot, DX was, everybody was hot, actually. And the business was so freaking good. People just remember it from back when they were growing up as a huge part of their childhood.
It is influential in their childhood. We had a guy come to us this past weekend and broke down in tears and said, me and Billy sitting there, he said, I was a foster kid. He's a grown man. I was a foster kid till I was 18. And no matter what foster house I went into, I wore my DX jersey. And I never had a problem. Everybody always went, oh, they're cool. And I was like, holy crap, dude. It was such a touching story. But I didn't realize. You know what I mean? I still, to this point, it's hard for me to fathom, like, what we did touched somebody's life, like, okay, I guess that's, you know, but it's just hard for me to fathom that. I know it's true. It happens. It's just hard for me to think about it that way.
Yeah. We as a knew what was going on, and we could feel it. We could feel the momentum. We knew it was working because we were getting results in the crowds, in the houses, and the numbers on TV. But we also could hear that reaction. But we really didn't have a clue what place it would take in history, if it would even take a place in
history. Right. Well, that's what, you know, that's what I hear a lot of, because this comes up a lot. I'm an old fat dude sitting there signing autographs and pictures of me when I was young and good looking. Well, I was never good looking, but I was.
Wait a minute. Yeah.
Yeah,
I was there. You were young.
But we talk a lot about that. And it's, you know, to me, when I was young and I was watching wrestling, Georgia Championship Wrestling was the best thing I'd ever seen in my life. And probably to this day still is. And that's because I lived in the South. It's what I watched. I was young and influential, or easily influenced. And so that was the best to me. Mr. Wrestling number two, Bob Armstrong, Brad Armstrong, Piper came in. There was some great stuff that was going on. I wonder if, like, because now people go like, oh, that was cool, and now it sucks. Well, does it suck now? Are there kids right now going, this is the best thing ever? And they'll take that memory with it, like John Cena's the best wrestler in the world, to kids all over the world. And, you know, the 600,000 smart marks that argue, oh, you can't wrestle a bit. Yeah, well, and so it just begs the question, when you were younger and easily influenced, was the wrestling better? So that when you got older and priorities change, you go, oh, it's not as good today. Well, it's not as important to you today as it was back then. So I think about that a lot, and it doesn't get me anywhere. But it's mental masturbation.
Well, are you still mad at Mr. Brisco for selling Georgia Championship Wrestling and ruining your childhood?
Well, a little bit. I mean, I'm glad you brought that up, because I wanted to confront him a little bit while we were at a safe distance, so he could beat on me.
I missed my opportunity. He had like knee replacement, and he didn't tell me about it until he was almost healed. I'd have flown down.
That's why he didn't tell anyone.
I would have flown down. I had a real shot.
John, over your right shoulder, there's a headless man standing there. I'm just wondering, is he okay? Is he just going to stand out?
Yeah, he's got, even got his cowboy hat on.
Yeah, look at him. Oh, he's got a cowboy hat on.
Yeah. Even.
Yeah. Looks like Stan Hansen saying about
it. My giraffe has a cowboy hat on, too. See?
Oh, man. This is
I can tell you just came home from Texas, where you must have had another birthday and your mom had you that party pony and all the gifts for a little cowboy hat.
Mr. Brisco, that is not necessary. That is not nice at all.
Have you ever seen his book, Brian, you know, Make Money Now by John Mayfield?
I'm sorry. I have not. But had I read it, I might have had more money.
You might have made some money now. You thumb through that, about halfway through there, and a full-page picture is John on his 16-year-old party pony that his mom got it for his 16-year-old.
My mom did not get me a party pony.
Is his feet touching the ground and everything?
No.
Yeah, I just put the quarter in the ear.
Oh, I love it.
You know what's amazing about your family is how Scott ends up older than Bullet Bob. That's the most amazing thing.
Yeah, that is. There's some Benjamin Button stuff going on there. And I don't know. Yeah, Scotty is literally 106 years old as of May the 4th, I think.
Yeah, I've known Scotty forever, just like I have you. And I've wondered when that pass came. You know, all of a sudden I knew him. Here was this young stud. You know, all of a sudden I look at him coming up to the gorilla position one day. Who in the hell are you, and what'd you do with Scotty Armstrong?
Well, sometimes up there will drain you.
Yeah, well, you know that for a fact.
Yeah, I do. But that ain't on nobody.
Yes,
that's the way of the world. That's the way the cookie crumbles. So if you don't like your cookies crumbled, then F off. You know what I mean?
Yeah. Brian, you grew up, of course, where we talked about your wonderful father and your family, your mom. I mean, what a wonderful lady she was, too. And wow, your entire family, I've had the honor of knowing for many, many years. But your brothers, you know, we all like to harass them. And I've, you know, it's so fun. But you know, you got into the business, you know, and by kind of a not you really didn't rely on your family's name or anything like that. You decided you wanted to serve the military, and you took off and you joined the military, and you went to a war zone, and you encountered a firefighter. Tell us a little bit about that and why you didn't want to jump right into the world of professional wrestling.
So all of my and I think, look, those of you that know me know this already, so it's not breaking news. I just do things on a wing and a prayer sometimes. I just
really
make decisions over a six pack or a joint or something. I have not made the best business decisions in my career, but this one was very shallow. It was very easy. I was 165 pounds, 6'4" when I got out of the high school. I was not going to go into professional wrestling at that size. I can tell you that much. So I thought my father was a Marine. I'll join the Marines. It'll give me some time. I'll put some weight on or whatever. And then I almost cemented the idea that if I like the Marine Corps, I may just stay in it.
Were your brothers in the business? Were your brothers already?
Yes. They were already. All of them were already in the business. And look, it was frustrating for me because I wanted to be in the business, but I was in no physical shape to do so. And I didn't want to do it like that. You know what I mean? And then after the military, I did put some weight on. I actually did try to re-enlist in the military as a drill instructor because I thought, in my mind, again, some shallow thinking, but it's how I thought, is what better? There's only one thing better than being a Marine, and that's being the person that makes Marines. And I thought, damn, that's a badass dude right there. I want to be that dude. And so I tried to re-enlist, but Clinton had just gotten to office, and that, you know, Democrats often cut military budgets and so forth. And so I could not re-enlist in the field that I wanted to go into being a drill instructor. I had to re-enlist as an infantryman, 0311 again. And I thought, well, I don't want to do that. I'm big enough to wrestle now. Let me try that, you know?
So Bill Clinton's responsible for DX.
But basically, and
I knew it.
Thank you, Bill.
I knew it.
It suck it. Where do you think?
Yeah, where do you think that saying come from, John?
You guys are dirty birds.
You think?
I love you. I fit right in.
Hey, but you and your dad had a very similar honor in the Marines, right?
Yes,
that's pretty cool.
We were both the honor men of the platoon. And so in like you marched across the parade deck holding the platoon guide on. And that's the flag, you know, you walk behind the officer, the smaller flag. And so we got to march across the exact same parade deck that he marched across 30 years previously. I got to march across also, and he was in the stands with the sergeant major of the whole depot of Paris Island, because the guy was from Montgomery, Alabama, and he had Bullet Bob Armstrong pictures on his walls in his house. Like, I was 3 days into Paris Island boot camp. I mean, I can't describe it, and you can't imagine it, but all of a sudden they go, Private James, it was private then, they changed it to recruit, Private James, report to the whatever. I had to run down there like, sir, yes, sir. And they were like, the depot sergeant major wants to see you. I thought, I've been here 3 days. What did I do now? And he called me in there. He gave me a cigarette. I didn't smoke at the time, but I like took the cigarette anyway and was like, he was like, calm down. It's okay. I just want to talk to you a little bit. But that's when he told me all about, I heard your father was, and the reason being is my father came to, they had like a the new recruits, they had their parents could pay and go on like a tour of the, you know, and see Paris Island. And dad wanted to go because he had been there 30 years prior. So he got to go, and word got around that he was my dad. And it was in the time where Bullet Bob was still a strong 87, I guess it was, still a strong name in the South. And that dude was a huge fan. And it, thank God, because he let me out of scrubbing the toothbrush on the toilet for 5 minutes anyway.
Your dad probably traveled like all wrestlers traveled a ton. So did it change your relationship very much when you became a Marine and you're basically following in his footsteps?
Yeah. We always had, and I hate to say it because it sounds like I'm shorting the relationships my brother has, but there's always been something very, very special since that since my service. You know what I mean? There's always been a connection and an understanding. And it's weird to say this, but you probably, you can't describe it. You can't articulate it, but you have that feeling with Ron when you're in a tag match. Like, I know what he's going to do. I know where he's going to be. I just know it was almost like that with my father from military service on. And it was really cool. Like, it was cool. I really enjoyed having that with him, you know?
And when in Iraq, you got to see, you saw some combat and you told me the story one time. You guys, like 50 of you guys or something, took 2,400 Iraqis prisoner.
Yeah, POWs, and just walked them back to the headquarters because we were set out in a patrol ahead, like ahead of the headquarters site. And so we brought them back there. They put Constantina wire in a huge circle and put them all in there. And then we got translators and we were out of the loop then, you know what I mean? But yeah, it wasn't like we overpowered them. They were running at us with their hands in the air, but it was so many of them that it was overwhelming. You know what I mean? So it was scary. I actually had I had a 9mm in my hand with my hand over the bottom because I didn't have a magazine in it. I just had the firearm, but I was the squad leader, so all of my fire teams and everybody had weapons, but I later realized I don't even have a magazine in it.
What were your numbers when those 2,500 or so surrendered to you guys? You guys were really outnumbered there.
Oh, too, yeah, right? A great deal. So till we came back, especially till we got them back to headquarters. But once you get them back to headquarters, like, you don't know, we had to frisk them all out there. And so it was probably 90 of us in all gathered those people and kind of walked them back 4 or 5 clicks to the headquarters. You know what I mean? And then, because you can't walk them into headquarters until you search them. So it was all, I tell my brothers this all the time because we talk about this. It ain't nothing you wouldn't do. Like going in the military and doing that, the hardest part was boot camp. The rest of it, I don't like to run. We ran a lot, but it's stuff, especially in combat. Your survival skills kick in and you just exist. You know what I mean? And you just,
speaking of existing and making do, you guys didn't have the barracks or anything like that. You lived what, in a sand hole that you
tell us
a little bit about the sand hole. I made sure.
Yeah. We did not have barracks. Headquarters itself had some tents, but we were out, like I said, out front. We dug fighting holes, and I lived in probably in the 6 months I was over there, probably 4 different fighting holes. But you dig a fighting hole that's about eye level to the tallest guy or to the shortest guy, excuse me. And so everybody in there can see out of the thing. And then you dig a little shallower hole behind that, that's your sleeping hole. And so when you're in a combat situation, you're 50-50 alert all the time. So 2 people in a fighting hole, one of them's in that sleeping hole behind the fighting hole, the other one's on watch, you know what I mean? So yeah, it was an interesting 6 months of my life, that's for sure.
And you got to know your whole buddy pretty good during that time.
Oh yeah, yeah, yeah. People can't talk about whole buddies. You teed that one up.
nothing like having a whole buddy.
Oh, I called the one my glory hole buddy. No, but it is. You do get to know those guys really good. Yeah. But it is, all kidding aside, it is, they're in this situation, their actions, your life literally depends on that. And my behavior and actions, theirs depends on that. You know what I mean? So it's a different kind of thing, but you do get to know what makes a man tick over there, that's for sure.
Did were you there during the summer as well?
Yeah, I'm trying to think what the dates were.
Because I mean, you're how exposed were you in your fighting?
100% exposed. yeah.
You know, if it rained, if it's 130,
110, 100, and the thing is it would be like 30 at night. You know what I mean? Like literally 110 in the day and 30 at night. And so look, it's a constant watering, water trucks come around and give you water every couple hours. And you know what I mean? It's, they bring you some, every now and then you got a hot meal. Like that was, even though it had sand in it, you know, it was still like, oh, this is a hot meal. So yeah, it was a, look, it was a different time in my life. A time I'm really proud of, by the way. Yeah. Like I'm really proud of my service.
So most of the time you guys were just eating C rations, right?
MREs, it's the same as C rations. And
I'm old. There were C rations when I was in the National Guard.
There weren't seven C's when Jerry was around. There was only like two.
Yeah, I was about
a long time ago.
It was manna.
That's right. He and Scott had manna together.
Yeah, then they broke manna.
It was good too.
Did you ever go back with WWE when they went to Iraq and Afghanistan?
No, they wouldn't let me go. Actually, the only one time they said, "Hey, you want to go?" And I was like, "Yeah, I'd love to." And then they came back and said, "It's probably best if you don't." I don't know if something else. I don't know what happened. I don't know why that decision was made. But I said, "Yes, I'd love to go." And they said, "No, you can't." And so I was like, "Okay."
So were you guys like the dog that caught the car when you brought back 2,400 prisoners? Like, look at this guy. We arrested the entire town.
Look at these guys. Yeah, apparently that was happening quite often. You know what I mean? Because, look, we encountered a couple of one-on-ones and a couple of three people, like scattered people here and there. They were always just trying to give up. Like, they were literally, like, they're hungry. They have no ammo. Their weapons are old and not functioning well. They had no shoes. They're in sandals, if anything. You know what I mean? Like, it's, they were literally said, "Here, take this gun and go fight them." And they didn't want to, you know what I mean? And so through the translator, me and the one dude talked, and he was like, "I just want to get back home to my family." And I was like, "Holy crap, that's what I want to do too." Yeah. You know what I mean? So it was eye-opening in a lot of different ways.
How early in the conflict was that, Brian?
This, we were over there when they broke into Kuwait, or they tried to, and that's when we were about a mile from the Kuwaiti border is where we were. So we were, look, it didn't last but 24 hours, but we were over there during that day. You know what I mean? So it was more after that first kind of breach into there, and then we kind of pushed them back in. It kind of stopped, but there was still scatterings of outlying, I don't want to say troops, because they weren't troops. They were just civilians that had been given a weapon and told to fight, you know, and they didn't want to.
They had, Jerry, when we were over there, they had a set of buildings that Hussein had built. They said they were bomb-proof. Every one of them had been destroyed by one bomb. They had every one of them had an exact hole in the roof. Yeah. Had been destroyed. That guy was so full of it.
We're pretty good at that stuff.
Were those guys, the guys you talked to, did they like Hussein? Did they hate him? Did they
want him? No, they were anti-Saddam Hussein. They didn't want nothing to do with him. And they would let you know that right away. Like, I think they were just forced to fight. But we saw people who were hanging that with a sign on them saying, "This person decided not to fight for us." You know what I mean? And so that's a strong incentive to keep hold of that gun and at least point it in the direction of the enemy.
So,
and when most of them didn't have the ammunition either.
No, they wouldn't. They didn't have ammo. Again, their weapons were horrible. It was like, I don't know what he was thinking. You know what I mean? I don't know what was going on and what yes man told him, "Hey, this is a good idea."
You know, people don't realize how backward, and I'm not trying to be mean to the people. A lot of the people were fighting. You know, that when I was over there with WWE, they had put out some disinformation that if you put a burlap sack over the part of the gun, that it will evade the radar and you'll be able to get through. Well, it blows up the gun. And the guys were actually doing it. They're actually killing people through this disinformation thing. Yeah. How to get around it. You know, it's just, I mean, it wasn't. These guys weren't prepared for anything.
No, they weren't. And I guess, how do you talk? I mean, and now you, maybe the outsiders see this, and then how do you, if I don't fight, they're going to kill me. But if I do fight, I'm fighting with the devil. You know what I mean? Like, I think they're in a, you know, they're in a really bad spot over there. And like I said, I don't want anybody to think I spider webbed them and caught them all. They were giving up in droves. We just happened to take the influx in that.
Brian, spike the football. You caught 2,400 prisoners. I mean, you're like Sergeant York, man, like Audie Murphy.
It is my story. Hell, I can tell it how I want to.
You're like George Patton. You invaded Iraq and I captured an entire
town. Never heard of the Desert Fox.
So during that time, you were coming back and forth between tour and you.
Well,
were
Sergeant Slaughter's got nothing on you, Brian.
Hey, he was actually, when I was over there, that was the talk of the world, was Slaughter turned on Hogan or whatever. Right. Like during that time, I don't know. That
wow.
Was,
so like, there was a lot of talk, or was a lot of talk going on about that?
It was just a talk between us, you know what I mean? About what? Sergeant Slaughter in this time of need?
So we're out here living in this damn sandhole.
Living in a sandhole, and that son of a
bitch. I'm out here with my whole buddy.
My whole buddy. We're trying to just survive. Hell, I'm a man. I got needs.
I can't believe Mr. Brisco called it your whole buddy.
No, I didn't call Brian a whole buddy. I said his whole buddy.
That's the correct nomenclature. It's called.
Okay, see, I'm correct here. I was in the military, John. I was respectful. I was a Spec 4, Brian. You believe
Are
that?
You really?
Yeah, E4, man.
Oh, was that during the Spanish-American War?
Yeah, but you know what? That's one we won, too.
Yeah, and I think I saw you. You were in that Mel Gibson movie, Patriot, I think it was.
You know, that's right, Brian. Me and your dad, we're whole buddies at Dirt. No, I think that was Scott. That was my whole buddy.
That might have been. It might have been. Yeah. Look, it was. I'll say this again because I think it warrants saying. Like, it was a really proud time of my life, personally. You know, I've done some things professionally that are cool or whatever, but that's the thing for me. Like, that means a lot to me. When I lay my head down at night, I don't think, oh my God, I was the hardcore champion. You know what I mean?
Well, it was so impactful in your life. You wanted to re-enlist. And,
oh yeah. Yeah. Like I was as patriotic as you could come right about then. We came back and you know, the rest is history.
What Look, happened?
This is the path
you met Billy Gunn, and you came by. So.
Then he met Chuck, and we're all the way back to old buddies.
Okay, so you come back, and you get Bill Clinton won't let you reenlist or what you want to do, so he's responsible for inventing
so really
DX.
The whole campaign was directed at him.
Yeah, so then you go up to Smoky Mountain, correct? I believe it is.
Yeah,
and that's how you get into business up there. And you were under a mask for a while, right?
Yeah.
I can see why, but why?
Because I've got a face for radio. But I did.
Didn't want his whole buddy to find it.
Yeah, but you should have seen how cute he was. My old buddy was. Well, looker.
Hey, have you ever?
Do you stay in contact with your old buddy?
Yeah. Have you kept up with your old buddy?
So I have kept up with several of them, actually. Brad Hayes is one of them.
Wow. And he's got a lot of holes, huh?
Hey, so actually, we had a child together, and he's 17. No, but Brad Hazlett I think it's in Wisconsin, is a member of like the SWAT team and to this day. And I follow him, and his son's now a member of the same police department.
He probably just buried his reputation, calling him a whole buddy now.
Yeah. Member of the SWAT team. He's put in the time, bless his heart. And I guess he's done it the whole time. But this is getting ridiculous. I love it. I don't even know what I was saying anymore.
It don't matter. We don't now,
that's what I have on my podcast.
Oh, I'm sorry, people. We completely lost control.
On my podcast, we have, when I forget what I'm saying, we have a sound of a bong hit, like, and then we have a chair shot sound. And that's the reason I forget where I'm at, is because of chair shots and bong resin. And so I'll use that excuse here as well.
We had a Q&A with Jerry at some deal, whatever it was. And Ron answered like first question serious, and then they went to Road Dogg, and it went downhill from there.
It went down.
We had a lot of fun.
I just did another one with Ron like 2 weeks ago, and it was just Ron and supposed to be me and Billy, but Billy just went in and sat in the crowd, like because I never let him say anything anyway. So I just go sit down in the crowd. So he sat down. So it was just me and Ron, and Ron was trying his hardest to just be as articulate and professional. I was just taking every opportunity to talk about dicks or drugs or whatever. Bless his heart. He was like, just get this dude away from me. I just believe in him. John said it best when he said, some people like to look good and some people like to feel good. Well, I still like to feel good. I just don't take things that make me feel
good. Billy told me that one morning, Jerry, on a plane. Billy, I said, where are you going, Billy? He goes, I'm going there early to go to the gym. I said, where's Road Dogg? He said, sleeping in. He goes, I'm in this world to look good. He's in this world to feel good.
You know, I heard that today on that fantastic. I'm going to plug it again. If there are fans out there hadn't heard it, man, WWE Network or Peacock Network, whatever the hell it is nowadays. But what is it? Legends interview where JBL interviews a Road Dogg. It's an hour and a half. And I hate to say it, probably it isn't going to be as fun as this show here, but it was very informative. You guys did a great job here, but we're here to have fun.
You know, 100%. You know who, the one compliment, thank you for that, Gerald, about that. I really enjoyed that interview as well. I really thought it was good, but the one compliment that took it over the edge for me was Vince told me, hey, Linda, watch your thing. She said she really liked it. And I was like, wow. Okay, because I couldn't believe he gave that bit of information to me. You know what I mean?
He didn't volunteer that either he had watched it or he liked it.
Yes, he did. He didn't want to tell me he watched it, maybe.
Linda watched.
But I thought, like, man, that was a good thing. That was a cool little interview show you had, John.
That was cool, yeah. That was cool.
How come it went away? Any reason?
I have no idea. I have no idea why.
The reason I'm sitting here doing this podcast.
Yeah, he got exactly. Demoted. He got demoted. Exactly. He ended up with me and you instead of just you.
Yeah.
I'd love to do something. John, you go back and do those. You're great at them too, by the way. You go back and do those panels and stuff for the WWE still, don't you?
Yeah, I go in like the
pay-per-views and stuff.
The pre-shows, yeah.
I would love to do that. Not to try to take a gig away from you, but I just
hey, thanks, Brian.
It's a different challenge, you know. It's something that I haven't done. Like, I'd love to do color commentary, and
I think you'd be great at it.
Yeah,
hearing some of the interviews I've heard with you, Brian. That was one thing you really wanted to get into during the Attitude Era, too.
Right? Yeah, for sure. I always thought I would be good at it. Now, look, I don't know what it entails, so I say, like, standing from afar without knowing any of the intricate, whatever the friggin' word I'm looking for, intricacies. Never mind.
Helping John.
The integral parts.
There you go.
I don't know if I beat people in my ear. I'm directing traffic. You know what I mean? There's a lot going on that I'm not privy to. So it makes me wonder, could I can run my mouth, but could I do it while somebody's yelling?
Oh, yeah, Brian, it's Vince's. I don't know where it gets that Vince is, you know, killing people in the ear.
Yeah, I wasn't so much worried about him, but I'm worried about, like, even Kevin or somebody that I'm directing traffic.
Right, I mean, I did the commentary for years. Vince was one. I'm telling you, he was wonderful to work with. I know Mick Foley had a problem with him. You know,
I would love to do that.
I screwed up many times. He never yelled at me. You know, he never yelled at King or Booker either. You know, it's one of those things. Now he yelled at Michael Cole a few times.
Yeah. I get it. There is that invisible line with him where there's a bit of a respect, and I don't want to put it into words and misquote it, but there is that invisible line where if you've put your body on the line, he's got some respect for you. You know what I mean?
Right.
I don't mean to simplify that, but
and
that's
he
what
he was so good at producing. He would literally just have so succinct. He would say just a few words, and you know which direction you want to go.
Because I would sit there during SmackDown recordings and listen to him pitch to stuff to y'all, and I would be like, oh man, and then I would hear y'all say it, and I would be like, oh, okay, so he's just passing them. Like, I never heard him yell at anybody either. I just heard him passing stuff, and then I would always pass stupid stuff when he wasn't there and see if they would say it, if Corey Graves would actually say it.
You know, man, I've heard him holler, guys. But not you two. Not you. There's not like you guys say, there's that certain line, you know, that and Michael was at the part two. I don't think he probably hollered at Michael probably as much as he did, but Michael needed a lot of help in those early days, if we all know it. And Vince got a unique way of helping you.
Well, look, that's what, you know, people always talk about. This is real to me. He paid for me to go to rehab, which in my mind and in my heart directly equates to me being alive today. He did the same for my brother, Scott. He then re-employed us for 10 years and paid me good and gave me life experiences, the likes that I'll never see again. And so what am I to be mad about? Who am I supposed to be mad at? Because I can't keep up with him? Because I can't outwork the superhuman worker? You know what I mean? The man is a machine, and he works and works and works, and I personally couldn't keep up with him. And that's on me. That ain't on him.
I experienced the same. And speaking of life experiences, I heard you and John and in that magnificent interview, let's plug it again, where you all of a sudden life experiences. You look up, you're in a private jet, and you look over there, John Layfield, and there's Michael P.S.A. and the three you got.
The three of us. It was just the three of us.
That just doesn't compute to a lot of people.
There was just the three of us.
That was just the three of us on that huge private plane. Three rednecks on
many,
a plane.
Yeah, many
on
night.
A private jet, on a private corporate jet.
Limo picking us up. That's the kind of stuff I'm talking about. A lot of people, and I would say a lot of people never experienced that in their life. That man gave me that experience. I don't know at what point I'm supposed to be angry because he's the big bad wolf to everybody else. You know what I mean? That ain't the way he is to me. And that's never the way I've seen him. Oh, I've seen him after I got screwed up and got fired and was still on drugs and wasn't thinking straight and blamed him for everything. I get that because I was, my mind was altered. Once I got sober and started thinking, you know, straight with it, with open eyes and a clear mind, holy mackerel, you change your perspective and go, this man, everything I have in my life, especially from a monetary standpoint, he gave me. Like, I don't know. You can not like him if you want to.
But I like him.
I've heard it with pride say, you know, I hired a couple guys that nobody would hire, you know, either because of criminal past or some type of record. You know, and he said they deserve a second chance. And he really believes that.
Yes, he does. When I went in there and told him, like, I was eight years sober, I think, at the time. And we were running hard. It was mania season. I'd been writing for like 2 or 3 years now. And so it was stressful. And I went and I said, look, I need a one-on-one with you. I need to talk. We talked. I said, I'm worried about my sobriety. He got up from around the table, hugged me, Brian, anything you need, you got to talk to me. We have to communicate. Like this is the dude that all the people on the internet say is the devil. You know what I mean? He's embracing me and telling me anything you need, I will give you. And he means that, you know what I mean? And he would do that. And so I don't know, man, I just got a different take than some people.
Well, I've heard him talk about you and talk about, I got big plans for that man. You know, he loved you. I mean,
he told me sitting on that same plane, I'm going to make an executive out of you yet. He didn't fail me. I failed me. You know what I mean? Brett screwed Brett.
People don't understand his work ethic. I mean, that's legit to what he does. It's insane. And he does it every day of the year.
Yeah. He does it every day, every day.
He asked me one day, he goes, how do you play golf? I go, what do you mean? He goes, how do you spend 4 hours out somewhere on some golf course? I don't get it. You're not working. It was like hell to him.
Yeah, because you weren't working. You were just relaxing for 4 hours. I told him, I said, sir, if you would please buy an island and a jet ski and just circle that motherfucker and let us just have it from here.
You know what always got me about commentary was it drives me nuts when people say, you know, the commentaries have to be legit. Really? We got a match in the ring. We know the finish. We know the high spots. We know within 5 seconds of how long that match is going to go. but the commentators are legit. That just always blew me away. They're part of the show.
It's, you know, the one people I think that is a good thing that we try to make them legit is the referees. Like, I know Vince is very strict on, hey, if they don't kick out or you count to three, if you disqualify them, he'll bonus a referee. Because that, to me, if you watch the separate other shows, that's the huge difference maker. Man, a tag match can just go haywire. And everything's fine. And they just go up in the stands and there's matches still going on. Like, it's at least on his one thing that I thought was, you know, was the officiating has to be legit. But I'm with you. The commentators got to be politicians. They got to be ready to spin some tales and tell some lies.
They
got to
be part of the show. Yeah, they're part of the show. We're actors, you know,
I would love to try it. And I've cast a wide net. I'm looking for Tony Khan. I'm looking for the other Khan. Anybody that will hire me and let me do color commentary, I would appreciate it. If I suck at it, I'll gladly walk away.
Hey, you know, the best part also is the rules are actually the rules until they change. You know, they're the rules for that match.
Oh, yeah.
They are legit, but some of you've been there. You know how it is.
No, I've been there. And it's whichever way the wind
goes. And during the course of the match, they can change real
quick. Yeah. So Conrad asked me that the other day, was like, has Vince ever changed a finish of a match in the middle of it? And I said, a million times. And he was like, really? And I was like, yeah, a bunch of times. But yeah, it's good to be the king, right? You're the king, you make the rules. I get it as a publicly traded company, but he's the CEO and he makes the decisions. And it's not like he's gonna make a decision to hurt his company, to hurt his bottom line. You know for a fact he's gonna make those decisions with monetary gains in mind, you know? And so.
And Brian, you're there in the 90s and people said the same thing about him then. Oh, he's crazy. He's out of touch. It's 25 years later. You've got the WWE Network. You're on Peacock now. And you got all these billion-dollar TV deals. And they're saying the exact same things. He's crazy. He's out of touch.
And wasn't his year last year or a quarter or something? Like, there was some reports that that was the highest ever. So, I mean, it's, you know, go figure. People on the internet are going to be mad about something.
One time he sent word that he didn't care who won the match between me and Wyndham against Los Boricuas. So I think it was George Steele was the agent. He goes, I don't know what to do. I goes, whoever they take is a baby face. And Barry goes, okay, we'll go out first. We go out first, Barry slapping hands.
By the time
they come to the ring, they're getting booed.
When he was Rockabilly and I was the real Double J, me and Billy would do that at the curtain. When nobody would just say, hey, whoever they take as a baby face, they go over.
that's how Godfather got invented. Me and Godfather were the popcorn match, and we were just beating each other up. I mean, we were as stiff as it could be, and no one cared. Finally, he comes out one day, he goes, hey, man, I'm going to try to cut a promo. I said, please do something. So he goes, you know what I am? I'm a pimp. And people started popping, and then he developed that whole thing because – He was with me and nobody gave a shit who we were.
Was he comma at the time? Or was he later?
He may have been. Yeah. I think he was comma.
So he also had to keep up his shoot fighter persona. Y'all were beating the shit out of each other. I know how that feels, man. I guess it was 8 years ago now, but this last little run with the tag titles, man, they'd pop for us our stuff. But once I hit my jabs, wiggle, wiggle, knee, 1-2, kick out, they started the heat. Nobody gave a damn. It's like, well, we got 8 more minutes, so let's sit here for a second. I'll fight up, and we'll see if we can't get out of here. But, yeah, it's just, hey, you're cool. I like you, but I'm not invested in you. You know what I mean? So I'm not going to really get involved in the match.
When Godfather first started getting over, I tell him one day on the house show, he's so used to either me going over, him going over, then nobody cares. I said, hit me with the whole train. And he goes, that's all right, we'll do it tomorrow. I go, it's the finish, Godfather, you're going over. And he goes, sorry, I'm high. No big deal.
I bet you money he was high, too. I bet he went
high. There's no doubt about it.
Well, one time, and this ain't, I'm not glorifying it, but one time we had that the same deal as when I hit you real hard, Bradshaw, and then thought we were done, and we were Chicago, Milwaukee, Chicago. It's like an hour and a half drive. And so we had a two a day, and I kicked Bradshaw or hit him or something as hard as I could, and then like ran to the back and ran out of there.
Well, Jerry, he kicked me in the back like a football kicker, kicked me as hard as he could. And I stood up. I said, "You son of a," and I stood up, and he punched me right in the forehead. Wham! And hit me, and I go, "Bastard!" And then he took off running and ran all the way to the dressing room, got his bag, and got in his car. It was gone.
I could have sworn we were good for the weekend.
We had a double shot, Jerry, and he didn't realize it. So I had him that night. So me and Ron drove straight to the building.
We had the exact same match in about 3 hours.
Yeah, we were waiting on him when they got there. As he walked in, I go, "You forgot we had a double shot, didn't we?"
I was like, "John, please, I'm sorry. I'm so sorry." But me and Godfather did that same trek one time, that 90-minute drive, and I never smoked so much pot in my life. I was useless.
That would be the night where you said, "I'm so glad to be in Detroit and you're in Chicago, Milwaukee," right?
It might very well have been. I'll never forget that was Al Snow was standing across the ring, and I said, "Detroit Rock City" or something.
Yeah, yeah.
Like in Missouri or something. And they start booing. I look at Al Snow like dumbfounded, and he's like, "We're not in Detroit, dumbass." So then I just told him, like, "Just boo me. Get it out of your system. We'll start over." We had fun, though.
Yeah, we did.
I witnessed that. Detroit Rock City. And they booed him because they must not have heard me. Detroit Rock City.
Let me say this. No, I can't hear you. Oh man. And then now Ron Killings does it as a pop. You know what I mean? Now he goes out and announces the wrong city as a pop line.
You know, me and Ron made him change one of his lines in his rap lyrics. You know, he called himself one of the best young OGs or something.
Oh yeah. Yeah.
Dude, that doesn't work. That's about 10 years past.
Yeah. I was about to say, you're an OG, but there ain't nothing young about you. But he still looks great, doesn't he? Like he
looks like he did 15 years ago.
It's incredible.
And he's funny as he could be.
Yeah. Anything he touches turns to gold. And that's just the truth. And so I don't know if you remember, but he main evented SmackDown a couple of times where I looked at Vince and said, "We're going to have R-Truth and Miz main event the show." And he said, "Just wait till I'm done." And I swear to God, the ratings went up and everything. It was a 2-hour story of Truth messing with I forget who. Oh, Maryse called her Carmella or something, you know what I mean? Like it was all just a mishap, step into on a rake, it comes up here, it was a great story. It was 2 hours. It was not the only time he ever changed my crap and I went, "Oh, you're screwing it up," and then I watch it and I go, "Oh, that was awesome."
You know, people don't realize the guys who play the dumb guys are the really smart ones.
Oh yeah, yeah. So
it's what Truth does is brilliant.
Yeah. I mean, in that particular episode, I remember specifically putting in a line in one of his backstages, because he had like four of them on that show, where they go, "Man, you're crazy." And he looks in the camera and goes, "Crazy enough to get in the main event."
I love what he brought a ladder out for some cake match or something. You know, he'd bring the wrong thing out for the match.
Oh yeah.
He'd
bring the ladder out there for the Royal Rumble
and climb the ladder and look up and my bad.
That's just gold. He's like, it's when I saw him, and I don't know, remember when Billy got hurt, but whenever it was, 99, 2000 early, I'm not sure, but Billy hurt his shoulder working with the Dudleys, and he was going to be out for like 9 months, and I had gone to do a show for King in Tunica, Mississippi at the casinos, and I saw Ronnie was rapping and working on the show for Memphis, and I thought, who is that dude? And Bruce Pritchard, Gerald's illegitimate son, Bruce Pritchard, was there.
Hey, I've never been called out before, man.
I said, "There's my," because I lost Billy, so I said, "There's my new tag team partner right there."
Oh, I think the world are killing.
Yeah,
I think
me too.
He is so entertaining. Yeah. And he's that way all the time.
All the time, everywhere. And yeah, he's just he's a great person. You know what I mean? Like he's
truly
a great human being. And Vince used to take him on all those handshake tours because he looks great. He's a great human being. He's entertaining as crap. Like I'd want to be around him too when I had to go to Saudi, you know?
Yeah, he just made a difference in everything we did. You know, one thing you talk about Vince changing the finish. I told a story the other day about somewhere, wherever it was, about when you had Tyler Breeze and Fandango, and they were going to have their first big match. And if you remember, everybody disagreed with Vince over Vince wanted to have him bring out a mop,
and
that. And people were saying, wait a minute, this is the first chance they get to show their talent. Yeah. And I remember afterwards, you said, you were sitting talking there, we were writers who were really upset about it. You go, guys, maybe like ice cream, and maybe vanilla and chocolate and different tastes, but they're both good.
Yeah. John, I went back into his office mano a mano post that production meeting and said, sir, you tell me to fight for my show. Please don't do this to them. I literally begged him, please don't do this to them. And he started laughing. And he was like, Brian, God almighty, don't worry about it. What if it does fail? Who cares? What if it does? And not only did it not fail, they were chanting for the mop. In Chicago, sold out, chanting for the mop that Vince suggested they put in their match. It was incredible.
And I was in the production when the production happened, production meeting happened. Vince was the only one that wanted to do it.
Yeah.
Everybody was against it.
And what they did was they went under the ring in the middle of the match and put on like custodian stuff and a wig and a fake mustache and came out like he was mopping the floor. Like even talking about it now sounds like it's the stupidest idea I've ever heard in my life. Had I not sat there 4 hours later and seen 15,000 people chant for the friggin' mop, I would have never believed it. It was incredible.
Just gold.
And that's him. That's him. I can't count on both hands how many times I disagreed with him and he was right. I can't think of once that I disagreed with him and I said, I told you so. You know what I mean? Never did he say something that I disagreed with that then he was proved wrong. Never. And that's the truth. That ain't me kissing nobody's butt. That's just a fact of my life, you know?
We're up in Canada one time, and he called me aside. He goes, you got a promo for tonight? He goes, you told me to think about one. I go, yeah. He goes, what do you got? I had this promo I was so proud of. I was like, this is going to be awesome. I'm going to get so much heat with the promo. And he just looked at me. He goes, just tell him you love him. What? So I said, all right, I'm going to do exactly what he says. I'm going out there, and I'm going to I went up there and I told everybody, I said, I just want two people from Canada to know I love you. And I'm proud to be your neighbor. And they're like, you asshole. I'm like, oh my God.
Look at what I noticed is like his process is like a process of extremes. You wanted to go out there and call him every name in the book. He said, what's the exact opposite of that?
That's right. What I mean?
And he said, oh, love him. So it's like, oh, there's too many dives tonight. No more dives ever. You know what I mean? Like that's
right.
And then of course you wiggle back into who needs to dive and who doesn't, and they get to do their thing. But it's like, he always does that. And it's like, okay, that works, because now you gave me a rule, no dives. Now, okay, but this one fits really well. I could go back and ask him if I can do it. You know what I mean? And he'll kind of let, but it's just how he works and how he operates, and it's effective.
You know, one thing we were on that Q&A, it kind of occurred to me, you and I and Ron and Billy were all in WWE, but we weren't exactly knocking the top off the main event chart. No. You were with Jeff.
Yep.
Billy was Rockabilly. Ron had a blue helmet, and I was Justin Hawk Bradshaw with a branding iron. I don't know if anybody would have ever believed that just a few years later, these are some of the main guys in the Attitude Era.
Yeah. Well, and that's what people go like, oh, how come they don't have characters like they did back then? Well, because the individuals themselves don't have the character. You know what I mean? It's like, I know that's deeper than I meant it to be, but like it's the people now don't have what it takes to grab my attention and jump off the TV screen at me. And if they did, I'd be tuning in every week, and so would everybody else. But I also hearken back to was it just a different time, man? Was it just a different time in society where F the police and you know what I mean? And like a different, I know it was, that was prior to us, but is that where society's bucking the system? We want to tell our bosses to suck it or kick them and hit stun them. You know what I mean? Like, was it all?
Well, that was the first transition.
It wasn't all the wrestling.
That was the first transition in pop culture. You know, you had Rambo, who was really a heel that was playing the babyface, and you had Clint Eastwood, who was wearing a black hat instead of a white hat, and he was the good guy. You know, you're starting to see the anti-hero for the first time come through, so it was kind of happening across everything.
Yeah, all platforms kind of entertainment. And that's a great point, because you're right, because Austin was that anti-hero, but man, what a hero when you're, you know what I mean, to the anti-establishment folk who work the 9-to-5, who want to kick their boss in the nuts and stun them, you know what I mean, or put a gun to his head and say bang and he pees himself. Like that was all great stuff that this guy was doing to his boss, who was an overbearing billionaire oligarch kind of guy. And so look, I loved it. I thought who's not in that, but again, I got a question. Okay, was it just a cool time, or was all of this so great that so many people were watching? So I don't know.
I think you got a combination of both of them, Brian, because, you know, you look at that locker room, you look at the talent in that locker room, it was just, you know, who's who of sports entertainment, of professional wrestling at the time when we became sports entertainment. But it was just a who's who of it. So, and society was changing so much at the time, too. We just hit that magic period, that magic spot. You know,
it was a catching a wave, right? It's just like catching a wave. Yeah. You catch that good one, and we rode it for a couple of years.
Yeah, did we ever? Well, tell us a little bit the New Age Outlaws, the DX. How did you guys did backstage? Were you? I mean, the click. You know what I mean, was you guys planning all this stuff? Tell
us how. So with me and Billy, like, and we've talked about this a lot lately because I just got released and now we're talking about our careers and stuff. But Billy and I were just working, like I said, the first match, Rockabilly and the Real Double J, and we were going nowhere. And those characters were both going nowhere. For one thing, they were very similar and we're fighting each other. And for another thing, cowboys were out. You know what I mean? It was the like you said, the anti-hero was in. The Marlboro Man is no more. And so we were kind of feeling like this is going nowhere. So we just got in Vince Russo's ear about putting us together. We didn't have any idea whether it would be good or not, but he tried it. You know what I mean? And look, he tried it in a way that, and I'm not giving him all the credit, but he was the one we talked to. So I'm sure the credit had to be decided on by somebody. But what they started doing was immediately we started like stealing the Road Warriors shoulder pads and the Blackjacks cowboy hats. And all of a sudden we're just taking the piss out of every other tag team and then winning along the way too. You know what I mean? And so it was very fast. I don't know really what was going on behind the scenes at that time, but once we kind of got established as, okay, these guys are going to do something. We don't know what the longevity looks like or the lifespan, but they're going to do something. So that's when I think Sean was going to go away and get his back surgery. We were kind of climbing that ladder. I think they thought, hey, if we grab these guys, he can fill the hole in the dike, you know what I mean? The leak in the dike until I get back from my back surgery. So I think that's kind of how it all went down. I was never in the click. I was always right on the outside of it because I was friends with Scott and Kevin and Sean and Hunter and X-Pac was in that click as well. I don't think I ever was a card carrying member, but I was friends with all those guys. And when I came in 94, like John was talking about when he was John Hawk Bradshaw and I was the Real Double J, or even before that, when I came back as the Roadie, I was friends with all those guys. And that's when my family helped me a lot too. Those guys all knew my family. So they all treated me well. And they didn't treat everybody well, to be quite honest with you, but they always treated me well. And I appreciated that for whatever the reason. So
well, you'd had a lot of history with Paul back at WCW.
100%.
Not a lot of history, but you had a couple of matches with him when he's terrorizing. And then
for sure. And I literally came to WWE before he did. You know what I mean? So then when he got there, I knew him. And so I like walked him around and gave him all the world's worst advice that he brings up to me a lot.
Well, you both turned out pretty damn good.
Yeah. We did all right. He did all right. I didn't do too bad.
You know, I've always thought the Click got a bad name for, you know, being bad. I was there, you know, yeah. And those guys, they were awesome to me. They were awesome to everybody around me.
Well, most important, you were there. You were backstage in a locker room. And yeah, you didn't experience any of that.
There was no division between, say, the Click, the BSK, the Canadian Boys. I mean, it wasn't. That's come about revisionist history.
You know, there wasn't faction heat. Everybody got along. Everybody got along. And you know what? What the difference was? And I saw you and Blackman do it one time at a baggage claim. If we had problems with anybody, you just settled it. You know what I mean? You just settled it, and then you went to work that night. And that's how it used to be. Now you can't, you know, you punch somebody and you get attempted murder, but at least they don't prosecute you very hard, so you get off in 5 years. And if you're a pedophile, you get off in 3. What the hell?
You know, one of the keys to your success, in all seriousness, is you didn't let Billy talk.
Yes, 100% agree with that. And to this
day, what makes me mad is Billy's not going to see this. And I'm going to have to repeat it to him because
He's still hot because I haven't had him as a guest on my podcast yet.
Can he turn on a computer yet?
Oh, yeah, I think, his wife will set it up for him.
His fingers are too muscular to do it. He's got Thanos fingers.
Literally poked holes. He poked holes. Man, he's all man. He's
Brian, we open up with a lot of, but your catchphrases, I mean, they're iconic in this business now. I mean, you know, all you got to do is, you better call everybody in the universe knows who the hell we're talking about. Was there any way that just come out of like a lot of stuff that John did, just came, you were out there in the audience at a spot show, and all of a sudden you say something, and wow, what a pop.
100%. And it was literally, at the time, me and Brian Lee, who was the Underfaker, and Chad of DOA, would literally, because that's at this time, like, there were still pagers and stuff out there and fax machines and stuff. So we would say, oh, you didn't know, you better fax somebody. Oh, you better fax somebody. You know, and we would just mess around. And I said, I'm going to say that when I go out here. And Brian Lee said, no, you ain't. And I said, you watch. So it was a dare. Like, I told him I was going to do it. He dared me to, and I did it. And hence, it fit perfectly with the down. Oh, you didn't know? Down. You'll ask me. You know what I mean? It just fit perfectly with it. And I was like, oh my God, that works. You know what I mean? And so there we were.
How did you ever get like Michael Buffer's spot somewhere?
I literally stole that other part from Michael Buffer. Like, it was just like, ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, you know? And so it was
great.
Yeah,
it was better than Buffer. And I hope Buffer hears that.
Yeah. Well, bless his heart. Talk about old. He's 7 years older than Scott Armstrong.
He's about my age. Brian, also, you mentioned your theme song. We had the great Jim Johnson. Did Jim compose that, or did you have any hand in it? Because I know you're musical talented.
No, that's Jim Johnson totally did that theme song. Now, he worked with me in collaboration with My Baby Tonight that we did, but he actually wrote that and played the instruments on it as well. So all I did was sing. But
saying you wrote My Baby Tonight? That wasn't Jeff Jarrett.
Well, to hear him tell, he sang it, and he's a member of the Horsemen. So,
I thought he was actually the leader of the Four Horsemen.
Yeah, I think it is the leader, not just a member. He is the member.
He's an honorary member of the Click, too.
Yeah. That was. So I forgot what we were talking about, but.
Jim Johnson.
Jim Johnson. Yes, sir. Yeah. So back then, look, nowadays, as I was working at NXT for the last 3 years as a senior director of character development, it was kind of a dusty spot, but all fancied up for a business card.
The dusty spot.
Yeah. But I dealt with individuals with their music and their gear and their everything about the package that they were going to present. So back then they played your music. And I mean, if you got music, you're like, oh, cool. They're playing some music for me. You know, I didn't know what nowadays they go on the third bar there. I want you to change that. And it's, you go like, what did we create here? And truth be told, I don't know what created that or when in time did it all change from, oh, you have all the power and I have none. When it used to be, you know, you got some power and I got some power. Let's talk about it and figure it out. You know what I mean? Like, it's all already now the talents are, I don't know, man. It's gone in the wrong direction, if you ask me.
I lasted 6 weeks as an agent.
Did you?
I did. Yeah. And that was 6 weeks too long.
That's a hard-ass job, too.
Did you request to be removed, or were you removed from duty?
No, I was not removed. I did walk in and say, I will not be back next week.
I'm not doing this.
I'm not doing it next week. Oh, no.
Hey, I tell you what, I got
to be there. What was your tipping point? What was your tipping point on that, John?
Sami Zayn? I love Sami. I think his character's great, but I was his agent, and everything was questioned. Everything was.
Hey, Sami, Kevin's the same way. Every single thing needs to be talked out and talked about a lot. And I'm talking about from the reversal of an Irish whip to, well, now, do you put your feet here or should I put? And it's holy mackerel. I would always just say, y'all put something together and come back to me, because I wasn't going to sit there and debate, because that'll do it. Sami Zayn will do it. Nicest guy in the world.
Sami is the nicest guy in the world. He's extremely talented. Yes. But when I had to work with him as an agent, as soon as the match was over, I walked up to John Laurinaitis and I said, I will not be here next week. And he says, is it that bad? I go, I'm doing commentary only.
Yeah, I totally get that.
When Edge and Christian come in, Edge and Christian were a lot, or Sami Zayn, I should say, is a lot like Edge and Christian. Edge, as you guys both worked them.
Yeah.
Ed breaks it down so minute. I mean, he's asking these questions. I'm a pro wrestler. What am I doing to analyze this damn thing? Yeah. I'm a wrestler.
That's the thing. Look, I guess that's a good thing to get grand.
It is, Ed was so good at it.
But it's also not, I don't need that. And I don't know if, I don't mean to come off braggadocious or if I have a gift, but you don't have to tell me where you're going to end up, dude. I'll look over there and see you, and I'll go to the opposite buckle. You know what I mean?
At one point, Sami asked me, he goes, what am I doing here? And I said, you're off camera. I don't care. And he goes, what am I doing? I go, I don't know. I don't.
It doesn't matter. Yeah. I don't care. And
your nose.
I also use this a lot. If you want me to do it, I'll do it for you. You know what I mean? Like, if you're in the match, you're in a moment in the match, what would you be doing at that moment? What would be fitting for you to sell on the floor? Are you, you know what I mean? I don't give a crap what you do, dude, but why are we talking about it?
Yeah, exactly.
You know, but to Sammy's credit, and I do mean this, I'm entertained by him to
100%.
You know, he was always a career babyface. You know, and he'd brag about being a career babyface. When he turned heel, he is one of the most entertaining heels I've ever seen. That stuff he was doing with Brock,
100%
beyond entertaining.
Entertaining in a way that doesn't make me like him, but I'm entertained by him.
That's right. You still dislike him, but it's still entertaining.
There's a fine line there, but he's great. He really is. Like, he's a great person too. Like, he does a lot of good work outside the wrestling world, and so. Him and Kevin both are kind of cut of the same cloth. Did you have a match with him and Kevin? Because you'd have just hung yourself then. You wouldn't have not come back. You'd have off yourself.
I was expecting like the Jack Lanza agent job. You know, like, yes. What are we doing? You're over.
Yeah, we got some.
And that's fur it. You're over.
I got some fur in the next town.
Yeah.
Sure y'all
you got a cigarette, Brian? You got a cigarette, Brian?
You're over. Don't go outside.
Here's a guy would smoke 80 packs of cigarettes a day. I'm exaggerating, maybe 10, but yeah, he would continuously smoke a cigarette. He packed one shirt for 3 days, and he smoked that cigarette package every When he went home, I said, Jack, how do you get in your house? Because when you get out of my car when you're going home, you smell like a damn tobacco fart.
Yeah, like-
He said, I walk in. I said, what do you do with all your cigarettes? And he said, I go through my bag at the airport when I get home. I throw everything away. I said, how about your shirt? I know you don't throw that away because you'll be wearing it next week. He said, no, when I get home, I go right to the washing machine, throw my shirt and all my clothes in the washing machine so my wife don't ever smell. I said, Jack, she never smelled you.
I saw him light a cigarette and take two puffs of it on an airplane.
Yeah, I've seen that.
On the armrest. Yeah. And when the person came and went and looked around, he looked around too. Like, what?
Yeah. He was the best. You know? when they banned smoking in arenas, there was always some asshole building manager.
That lady back in Houston. I mean, that was a contest. I remember her, that old lady back in Houston.
Oh, yeah.
She used to get on Pat, Jack every time.
And they tell Jack, you're not smoking. So Jack would put a cigarette in his mouth, and he would sit there, and for like 30 to 45 minutes, he'd go to light it while he's talking to somebody.
Yeah.
And he'd pull it out, and he'd listen to him. And he had never light it, but he'd go to light it again, and then he'd put out a list. And they're just waiting about 10 feet away. Jack would terrorize them with that.
He was the best, man.
Back in the days when airports were just going smokeless, you know, and we had guys like Patterson and Lanza, you know, that were smoking fiends. They get off those airplanes, don't you? You couldn't smoke in an airport as soon as they get off that airplane, they'd reach for the cigarette lighter.
Yeah.
Here comes the security. Oh, I'm sorry, I forgot. They put the cigarette out, go about 50 feet down the concourse there, light back up. Here they come, sir, we told you can't smoke in here. Well, they changed them all the way to the other
house.
But they would get a cigarette by the time they got through.
Have a whole cigarette smoke.
You know, you were backstage in Vancouver that one time when we had the riot, a bit of a riot, and they're throwing all kinds of people out. It was some type of holiday, and everybody was drunk, and the crowd was really bad. It was when DX was pretty hot.
I was probably drunk, too.
Yeah. Some guy comes to the back, and he had thrown something at one of the wrestlers. And as Jack walks by him, he just knees him in the thigh, and nobody sees it. I saw it, and I'm like, that's one of the coolest things I've ever seen.
Charlie
and Horse. He buckled the guy. The guy goes down. That's awesome.
The kayfabe Charlie Horse.
Kayfabe Charlie Horse from this 70-year-old man that just dropped this kid.
And had great times with him, too.
Jack was the best. I mean, he was just, what a freaking agent.
One time, me and Christian, we've talked a lot about them. I kicked Christian one time in the back so hard, bless his heart. He couldn't breathe. And I just got him in a rear chin lock. I said, catch your breath. And as soon as he caught his breath, I popped him up, kicked him again. And I was like, hey, Paul Orndorff beat me up when I first got in here. So I don't know. I forgot what we were talking about. Jack Lanza, me and Christian were having a match, and we went like literally like 6 or 7 minutes early. Like, and I just, Christian was the first one back. I don't know if he won or what happened. I don't know what happened, but I've heard Christian and Jack both tell me the story back, so I know it's true. He got to the back. He said, what the hell? What, 6 minutes early? We need more time. And he was like, he said, go home. And then here I came walking back, and Jack said, hey, good match, kid. And I just walked out. Right by, and Christian always told me that. Like, he didn't say shit to you. He buried me. That's how it works, Jack. He worked with my dad, man. Smarten up.
Yeah. We ran Cape Girardeau one time, and Jack wanted to get back to St. Louis. He ran the show in 1 hour and 14 minutes, and the whole show counting intermission. he got heat.
Remember. Back then, I think, Gerald, you can correct me if I'm wrong, back then the live event report or whatever was just a phone call to the office.
Yeah.
Like, hey, we're all good. You know, everything's good.
The agent report were, especially Lanza, when he really knew Vince was watching, Lanza would write the most immaculate agent reports you've ever heard in your life.
Really?
Yeah. I mean, he was very articulate. One time, it was so articulate. I remember exactly where it was. We're in Dallas. Get the agent report. You know, it's early call there for production meeting. And for once, Vince is on time. So Finkel brings the agent reports in and gives it to all of us. Vince starts reading the agent report. He gets up and he walks to the back of the room and he turns his back to the rest of it. He turned around, he got the reddest eye I've ever seen in my life. We're all reading this agent. And Lanza's, you know, Vince, you'd really been, your dad was looking down from the stars above, one of those things, writing about his dad, very eloquent. So Vince said, I got to read this agent report. We don't usually do it, but I'm gonna. And he started crying. He actually started weeping during reading the agent report, and we had to quit the agent report and had to stop the production meeting for about 3 minutes to actually compose himself, because Lanza was once again was he wanted some days off, I think. So gets a Vince's ass picked.
Hey, he got them heartstrings. You know, Laurinaitis tries to do that now, and he does
now.
very wordy, but it's not inside heartstring stuff like that. Jack was a worker, right? He was the best.
Yeah.
That night in Cape Girardeau was afternoon, and he wanted to get back to St. Louis because he had worked in St. Louis a lot. So obviously he wanted to get back to St. Louis.
Yeah.
So, sure. So I worked with Barry Windham first match, and Jack goes no more than a minute. So, first match. So we walk out. The bell has just rung, and Jack's walking down the aisle. And he's waving his tie. He goes, guys, I'm not kidding.
Time, boys. I love it. I loved his style. I did, because it was no nonsense. Get the job done. Don't slack the job. Do get the job done, but then have fun. You know what I mean? It's not so serious.
I've talked to Jack many times about his philosophy of being an agent, because, you know, we had some really, really different agents back in there. And I think that's really what really helped the business, was the different personalities in the agents. Where Jack had drawn money everywhere he had been and been a major star, a major player in every territory he had been to. So Jack, I said, you know, because Vince was getting to the point where at this time where he really wanted everything choreographed. You know, he wanted the agent to have 100% input in it. But I was told to talk to Jack about that philosophy. And I said, Jack just shook his head like, look at you, shook his head. Light up. And I said, well, what do you think you should do, Jack? He said, you know, you were in the ring. Did you like it when somebody came to you and told you ever move? No, I like to feel it. He said, these guys are the same as we were, Briscoe. He said, you can't script everything. You got to feel the match, right? And his answer to me was exactly my mindset, but it wasn't the boss's mindset.
Well, exactly. And look,
but Jack got by with it because he had such a good relationship with
Vince. Yeah, I think Vince knew. Maybe he's never going to be a general, but he's a damn good
gunner. He's a leader. He's a leader.
Leader of men.
That was the thing. Jack was a leader, and there wasn't a talent and on our roster that wouldn't jump in front of a car.
100%. He was a well-respected man.
And he had such a good way about him. You know, he never would say, hey, do this, do that. He would say, you know, you might want to try this.
Yeah.
And he'd put it in your head, and then you would think about it overnight. The next day you'd come back and you'd say, hey, Jack, I'm thinking about trying this. You know, he had suggested it, but now it's become your idea.
Yeah. And he had a great way of communicating too. Like I never heard him like yell. When he got mad, he just would cuss a little more. You know what I mean? Like it was, I don't know, I just always appreciated his approach. It was fun.
He got mad at me one time when I stole the van in Winnipeg.
Well, now, dang, John.
And he thought I was messing up his hotel deal. So he pulled me in the shower.
He might have been.
That night, and he was mad. And he looks at me. He's got that cigarette, and it's just me and him and maybe Timmy White or somebody for a witness in case he beat me up or something.
Yeah.
He's sitting there, and he goes, you know, you're a dumbass. And I said, yes, sir, I have no excuse.
Guilty.
And that just broke the ice. He goes, all right, just don't do it again.
Yeah, you know what? The truth of it is, it's the same with Vince. It's like, or anybody really of a figure of authority comes to you and says, hey, this happened on your watch. If you say, yes, it did, and I'm sorry, I've made a wrong decision and I won't do it. Like what? It kind of puts the fire out. You know what I mean? Like I own it. It was my mistake to own, and I own it. Now what are you going to do? You know what I mean? If you want to punish me or something, because, okay, whatever. But You own it. Own it. If it's yours to own, own it. You know what I mean?
Yeah, and it's so much easier that way.
I agree. It's so much easier to say, I think people respect that a lot more, too. People are very forgiving if you own it up. Own up to what you did and kind of go like, look, I realize that was wrong, and I'm going to try to correct it going forward. People are forgiving.
You know, and Vince is really like that. You know,
yeah, 100%.
If you ever try to swerve him, he'll never forget that.
Oh, he'll never forget. You lied to me. You tried to work me. You deceived me. You know what I mean? And they should be game-changing actions in a relationship, whether it be professional or personal. Like, though, a betrayal, you know what I mean? Something like that should be looked at like, holy crap. But, like, yeah, he believed in second chances, but when you deceived him, you might not have got that second chance so quick.
Yeah, he won't forget it. It may not be that day, and it may not be the next month, but he's not going to forget.
Yeah.
If you're making him money, he don't forgive you one down the road somewhere.
Yeah.
And then sometimes if you're not making any money, I've seen him make up with guys that weren't making any money and bring those guys back in.
Yeah.
Too.
Yeah. That's people just don't know him. They know that he's the big leader of the big, huge entertainment conglomerate that rules the world and the wrestling world. And so they throw rocks at the mountaintop.
The evil emperor.
Yeah. They don't know. They don't know him. You know what I mean?
Yeah, they don't know what he's done for so many different people. I mean, taking care of so many people.
Yeah. And he has carried a lot of people for a lot of years and continues to do so. There are tales, and you guys know, we don't have to share them here, but there are tales of his loyalty going way back to D.C. and all, you know what I mean? So, yeah, he's a loyal man, and he's a businessman. Look, that's what you can't fathom. I can't, because I'm not a businessman. I would be a horrible businessman because I care too much about so-and-so's kids at home, so I got to give her extra hours or something. You know what I mean? Like, I think I would end up going in the hole. But he makes decisions like that on a daily basis, and that's above my pay grade, man. I can't fathom that, so I can't critique it or put it over. I just know how successful he's been. I have been because of it.
And he takes care of more old wrestlers than billionaire Connie.
Oh yeah, 100%.
You know, he was taking care of wrestlers under his dad's tutelage.
100%. That's what I was talking. That's what I was talking about. Tails.
I was there. I mean, when it was happening, yeah. You know, I was part of that. Part of when he took over for his dad, I was there during that takeover, and I witnessed it first class, and I hand delivered a lot of bundles to friends of his dad in various roles and everything.
Yeah, and you'd see it all in different parts of the country. You'd see, you know, old guys come around.
Yeah.
And Vince had been taking care of him for years. I mean, for years he'd been taking care of him. You know, nobody ever mentions that. You know,
nobody
really knows about it because Vince doesn't do it to.
Right. That's not the way he does it. He does it in the closet. He doesn't do it out on the corner for all to see. And so if that's a fault, which I disagree with, it ain't his. It's somebody else's. You know what I mean? Because I think that's a great thing.
Well, Brian, We've been so excited to have you on. We're just as thrilled after we had you on that.
Did we talk wrestling today, or were we just bullshit?
I kind of like the idea of bullshit, to tell you the truth. I talk about wrestling every other day.
Oh, man, I went on in that, and you know, that's one of the great things about this show, and is you'll find out you get to do a lot of research on guys that you've known forever. You know,
yeah.
And then we get on this show and we just become friends again. You forget all that bullshit you were going to ask, but you know what? I've been just as happy with this show.
Amen. And the truth of it is, Gerald, it is just bullshit. You know what I mean? It's the all the stuff we look. Wrestling's huge, and I love it, and it's my passion. I've loved it since I was born, and I love it to this day. But it ain't the most important thing in my life. You know what I mean? It's kind of priorities have changed. And I know that's with age and with sobriety, but my priorities have changed. And I got grandkids. I got stuff that matters. I can live in an apartment as long as that kid calls me pawpaw and hugs my neck. You know what I mean? Yeah. So all that stuff is just kind of bullshit. We're talking today about the stuff that matters. You know, like smoking weed with the Godfather.
Yeah, that's right. Hey, Brian, you know, it's funny because I haven't seen a live event other than, say, a WWE event for a long time. I don't know how many years. And we were in Liverpool together. And Scottish guy, Gordo, Frodo, what was his name?
Grado.
That guy was – we're sitting there, Jerry, we're sitting there watching this live event, and we're sitting in the back, you know, like we used to do, you know, critiquing all the stuff, you know, taking shots at people. And Grado comes out. It was so freaking entertaining.
Yeah.
And we're sitting there just laughing and cheering. You know, it's just
when he was done, we just left because I thought it's all downhill. You know,
that's all the fun you needed right there.
Yeah, everybody was trying to have this serious wrestling event. And like the people there, they were from a comic con, you know, or a wrestling con or whatever. They didn't come out here to see the friggin' Ring of Honor wrestling tournament. They came out here to be entertained. These guys tried to wrestle. Nobody gave a crap. Grado came out there, and I don't know, Gerald, if you know his character, but he's not built well. He wears a singlet. He's Scottish as the day is long, and you can barely understand a word he says, but he is so funny and so entertaining in his mannerisms in the ring. He's not a good wrestler at all, but was the best wrestler on that card that night because he just.
But he was you know? The most entertaining thing we saw all day. It was.
Well, so you know, that's it. Some of these independent shows, I get to go to a few of them, and I'm entertained in a lot of them. You know, a lot of them, it's just, you know, please get this match out of the ring. But a lot of them, you're there, wow, you know, that's, you know, then it's, they for some reason just, you know, haven't clicked to the right people. And some of them don't want to click to the right people, too. Some of them are happy just doing that weekend.
Yeah, they're being a weekend warrior.
Yeah, and they're good at it. You know, I always tell them, no matter where you want to do, just be the best you're going to be. If you're going to be that weekend warrior, be the best damn warrior.
And they are. It's like don't imitate what you can't duplicate. Yeah. You know, it's like people are trying to be the Road Warriors in the early late 80s and early 90s.
Yeah,
you
Brian.
Can't. Nobody worked. You know, they're the Road Warriors.
They
had this gimmick and they had the market cornered. Yeah. And if you're going to come along as a tag team, be anything but them.
Yeah.
And that just goes to some people, because you see a lot of it today, people that just try to imitate what they see on TV. And it's like, man, I don't know, just work to your strengths and minimize your weaknesses and be you. You know what I mean? Be the first you that's out there, not the seventh rock, you know?
Yeah, that you know, when I'm recruiting these college kids, I want to be the next Rock. I said, no, you don't. You want to be the next whoever you are. You want to be the guy 15 years from now when I'm talking to the next guy. That guy says, I want to be the next.
I want to be him.
You look at the guys who are the big draws. You know, they're all different. You know, Gorgeous George was different from Bruno. Bruno's different from Hogan, different from Stone Cold, different from Rock, different from Cena, different from Roman Reigns. You know, they're all completely different. Nobody comes along and is the next Stone Cold. You've got Stone Cold. You don't need the next.
And there's, to me too, what was great about that Attitude Era, and you mentioned it up front, John, was we were there for a couple years feeling out who we were and what we were going to do and kind of evolving a little bit. When it got to Attitude Era time, there we were. You know what I mean? So that another thing is people got to get in the time in service a little bit before they realize who they are and who they need to be in the ring. And it may be totally different from who they thought they were going to be when they started. But I thought that was a cool evolution for us, 94, 95, early 96. And then it started, you know, 97, we started rolling. And so I thought it gave us all time to kind of feel ourselves out a little bit, which for me personally, I needed because I had no idea what I was doing.
Well, Brian, once again, thanks so much. Where can the folks find you? Where can they listen to you? Tell us about your new podcast.
Everywhere. Yeah, thank you, Gerald. Everywhere you get your podcast, Spotify, Apple, you can, watch on YouTube. And if you do, give us a 5-star review. That always helps. Even if you think I suck, give us a 5-star review. I think you'll
just hit that little thumb and thumb, right?
There's a little sign like this. Please hit that. So just starting this out and utilizing Ryan Katz, which I know, Gerald,
I love Ryan. Yeah.
He was the first guy under Dusty at FCW when it was Florida Championship Wrestling and then transitioned into NXT. So he is my co-host. So he brings a different kind of flavor to the show too, which I really enjoy his energy. So yeah, check it out, man. That's all I'm doing. Look, I'm unemployed. I'll sweep your Tony Khan. I'll clean your crapper. I'll Vince. I've still got a heck of a curveball.
Which Khan is Tony? Is that the AEW or is that the
WWE? Yeah, that's the AEW.
I think, is this all the work where this Khan family is trying to take over our business?
I swear to God, that's crossed my mind.
Never know in our business.
Oh, you never know. And the next thing you know, Jed's a millionaire and we're showing up in Jacksonville.
That's right.
But
Stranger things have happened. I showed up in Panama City one time.
I showed up in Panama City. Do you remember that?
Yeah, you were there,
I had just been fired and I lived in Gulf Breeze. It's like an hour from Panama City. WCW was in Panama City. I'm going to go get a job. I show up in Panama City. Everybody from WWF is there. And I see everybody and I go, boy, my timing is the shit.
That's awesome. I'd never heard that.
Yeah, that's a true story. And actually, I stayed, went out and with a bunch of the boys, and we got in a big fight that night in a bar. Like, I don't remember it, but I'm told we did well. Good Lord. How are we still alive? Guys, thank you so much for this. It's been really fun for me, and I appreciate the opportunity.
Hey, we love you, Road Dog. Thanks for coming on.
Thank you.
Love you guys, too. Thank you all.